Good morning. If you've got a Bible with you, let me hear you say word. I got that from a friend of mine named T-Bone. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Psalms. Psalm 34. It's right after Psalm 33. I learned that in Old Testament survey. When you get to Psalm 34, let me hear you say hallelujah. All right, for those of you not in seminary, you've just learned your first Hebrew word. It means praise the Lord. So now you can go home and tell your mom and dad that you're biblical scholars. Psalm 34, I'll read aloud. You guys read along silently with me, beginning with verse 1. I will praise the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will boast in the Lord. The humble will hear and be glad. Proclaim with me the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt His name together. I sought the Lord, and He answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to Him are radiant with joy. Their faces will never be ashamed. The poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him from all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear Him and rescues them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. How happy is the man who takes refuge in Him. Stand with us this morning as we proclaim musical praises to our God and King. May we taste and see that He is good today. And may you be satisfied with the riches that only He can provide.
Lord of all creation, water, earth, and sky. Heaven's your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. Holy Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth.
He is worthy of our praise.
Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
Let's sing hallelujah, praise the Lord. God of wonders,
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy, the universe declares your majesty, oh yes, you are holy, holy, God of wonders beyond our galaxy.
Here at the foot of your cross, humiliation, yet you regret not the thought of giving your own life, enduring suffering and shame, so that we might be born again. So we lift you up with a song of praise, for you are the only name above all names, and Lord of Lords, we worship you. We worship you. Yeah, we worship you.
We gather here at the foot of your cross.
We gather here at the foot of your cross, humiliation, yet you regret not the cost of giving your own life, enduring suffering and shame, so that we might be born again. So we lift you up with a song of praise, for you are the only name above all names, and Lord of Lords, we worship you. We worship you. Yeah, we worship you.
You guys take a moment to greet those around you. Let's lift together the name of Christ.
So we lift you up with a song of praise, for you are the only name above all names, and Lord of Lords, we worship you. We worship you. Yeah, we worship. We worship. We worship you.
You may be seated.
Well, God bless you. Thank you so much for being here. We want to welcome you to our annual Campus Youth Day here on the campus of New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. This is a day that has been set aside for a number of years to do a chapel service, just a little bit special, one that is directed toward those students who are in junior high and high school. We've done it especially for our campus students because many of them are out of school on this day because of the Mardi Gras festivities and being out of school, some of them much of the week. And so it is a privilege for us to invite them every year to come and be a part of this. And we've just kind of expanded that and tried to extend an invitation to youth groups in the area who may be in the same situation and just have a time where we celebrate your life, your ministry, and your walk with God. So we're glad that you're here today. I want us to go to the Lord in prayer, and I'd like to direct our praying toward these ministries. I want to ask you, whether you're a student at New Orleans Seminary or not, if you are a youth pastor or you serve in a minister of youth capacity, if you would just stand and remain standing just for a moment. Would you stand up all over the place? Wonderful. God bless you. Could we just welcome these and say thank you? I want you to... I want you to stay standing because I want us to pray for you. You are shepherds of this incredible generation that is out there, and we owe a debt of gratitude to you for your service and the ministry you do. We know it's not easy, but we're grateful to God for His calling upon your life. What I would like to do with you is ask those students that are here today, junior high and high school students, if you're here in our worship time this morning, would you stand and remain standing as well? All right, wonderful. Let's welcome these guys. I want you to remain standing. I'm going to ask Tony Morita, one of our evangelists and a student in our PhD program who is often out and about speaking to student groups and preaching God's Word. I'm going to ask him to come and lead us in a prayer this morning. And those of you that are seated, I just want you to have in mind these that are standing as we lift them before the Lord. We're grateful for their presence, but more than anything, we're grateful for the ministry that you have. And I want you to pray for these junior high and high school students that are here today. Folks, it's not like it was when we were growing up. We can sit and say that all we want, but they have a much tougher row to hoe. It's a different world out there, and we know the challenges that they face, and I want us to pray for them. Tony, you come and lead us in prayer.
God, this is a day that you have made, and we're glad and we rejoice in it. And we know the very breath we breathe right now is a gift of your grace. And so the only way that we can come, Lord, this morning is in humility before you, the King of Kings, the Lord of Glory, the great I Am. We give you praise today for who you are. And God, we thank you for those you've called out for student ministry, these student pastors, Lord, who stay up late at night and sometimes feel like they're teaching to a wall. And Lord, have to deal with discipline problems and all the areas that are tough. God, we pray you continue to grant them grace. But God, we know they're there not just to endure the suffering, Lord, but we thank you for the joy that you place in their hearts. We thank you for the love of students that you've placed within them. We thank you for the vision that you've given them for this generation. And God, we would just ask this morning that you would pour out your Spirit upon them. We pray that you would give them a renewed love for your Word, a renewed love to teach your Word. We pray, God, you would fill them with your Spirit. Help them, God, to be bold. Help them, God, to train up these students to be the leaders of our next generation. We pray you would give them souls as they go in schools, God, and as they have Wednesday night services and weekends and lock-ins and everything else that goes on. God, I pray for a great harvest in their ministries. And God, we pray for these students. We thank you that you brought them to this campus, and I pray that they would not only feel welcomed, but I pray today they would be blessed. And I pray, God, that you would do as the psalmist said, and you would open up their eyes that they may behold wonderful things from your Word. And we do thank you, God, for this generation, and I pray you would instill in them today a passion to live for your glory, a passion to bring their friends to Christ. And God, we would pray this morning for our preacher. I pray that you would fill Vody with your Spirit. We thank you for what you've done through him in this land. And God, we pray you would raise up an army of men just like him who are committed to your Word and to your work. So we give you this hour, God. We know unless you come, we're just making noise up here. Unless your spirit comes, nothing's going to happen of significance. And so, God, we would ask you this morning not just to make this another time if we can check off a box or just to come attend an event, but I pray this morning, God, that you would show up in power, surprise us by your power. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much. Be seated. We also want to welcome those of you that are joining us by way of the internet broadcast today. Thank you for coming and hanging out with us during this time of worship. We're grateful for your carving out the time to do that. I want you to pray as you go throughout the day for the family of Dr. Jerry Pounds. He formerly was one of our vice presidents here in New Orleans Seminary. His mother passed away on Monday, I believe, of this week. Our president is representing us today at that funeral. And so you be in prayer for Dr. Pounds. He is the president now of one of our Baptist colleges in the state of Georgia and doing an incredible job there. But we want to pray for that family today in their loss. It is an honor for us to be led in worship today, in musical worship, by the group NC2. Byron, I'm going to ask you if you would step up to the microphone and would you introduce your band to us?
This is Shannon, Matt, and Chris.
And this is Byron Townsend. Let's welcome them to our worship time today. Maybe one of the most difficult combinations to find in our day and time is someone that can communicate to the student generation today, but in doing so refuses to compromise the solid teaching of God's Word. Now that is not to say that those are not out there, but there certainly is a temptation many times to feel like those two things don't go together, that we can't to communicate to a contemporary culture by being true to God's Word, being faithful to it, and letting it speak for itself. I am very grateful that God is raising up a generation. Many of you are a part of that generation who knows that is not the case and is very committed to the exposition of God's Word and the teaching of God's Word with integrity to a student generation today. One of the individuals that has paved the way for that and set the example for us and held the standard high has been Dr. Bodie Baucom. And it's an incredible privilege for us to have him on our campus today as the one who would bring to us God's Word, the one who would challenge us. Many of you have had the privilege of hearing Bodhi in a number of different venues. He was in our city some months ago, I think, at Zephyr Stadium doing an event. Others of you have encountered him in different events around the country, and you know what I've said about him and bringing those two things together is true. He is the founder and president of Bodie Baucom Ministries, a ministry that has its hand in a number of different types of things in proclaiming God's Word. He also is partnering with Lifeway Christian Resources in an upcoming book that will be out in May. Bible studies related to that will actually be released next week, and I believe it has to do with apologetics in a contemporary culture, in this culture in which we live, and we're anticipating those resources being available to all of us. He has a wife and two beautiful children, 11 and 13. They reside just outside of Houston, Texas. Bodie, we are privileged to have you today, and we look forward to you bringing God's Word to us after another time of musical worship.
Stand with us as we continue our musical worship. Psalm 103 says, "Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. And forget not his benefit. He who forgives your sins, he who heals you from diseases, he who lifts you up from the miry pit and crowns you with love and faithfulness." May our souls praise the God who has brought us from darkness and transferred us into his marvelous light, that we may declare his praises and his glory.
Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord.
Let us praise Him this morning. Think of the sins that He's forgiven you of.
Oh my soul, praise the Lord. In the morning, praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. Over the mountains to the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hand. For I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love
over the mountains to the sea.
Over the mountain to the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hand. For I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love.
All right, girls, you sing this with me.
Everywhere I go, I'm singing. Every breath of air I'm breathing. Everywhere I go, I'm singing. When your love came down. Everywhere I go, I'm singing. Every breath of air I'm breathing. Everywhere I go, I'm singing. When your love came down.
All right, girls, keep singing that, girls.
I'm singing. Every breath of air I'm breathing. Everywhere.
All right, guys, we're going to sing I Could Sing of Your Love on top of that. Here we go.
I could sing of your love forever. Everywhere I could sing of your love forever. Everywhere I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever.
As one body, let us proclaim our love to the King. I could sing.
I could sing of your love. Oh, I could sing of your love. I could sing of your love.
Sing of your love forever.
Forever.
I could sing of your love forever.
Over the mountain.
Over the mountain to the sea. Your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth. And I will daily lift my hand. For I will always sing of when your love came down.
Spend some time with the Father if you haven't already this morning. I want to invite you to draw a circle around yourself, just in your mind. Kind of forget about the person on your left and right, those sitting in front of you or behind you. And ascribe glory to the Lord. We've told Him that we could sing of His love forever. But has He done a work in your life? And is He daily doing a work in your life whereby you indeed could sing of His love forever? Father, our desire is to know You, to know You and to make You known. Recently, my wife and I, or last year, we were in Alaska. We had the opportunity to go up there, and we were next to a couple of glaciers, and there were just mountains, and there was a big valley, and we were in one of those little boats that you do glacier cruises on. Just the beauty of the water and the grandeur of nature, couldn't help but to think, wow, God, indeed the heavens declare Your glory. And so started thinking just about the Lord's grace and His love. And these are some thoughts that came to mind, and they're going to be on the screen, and you're welcome to sing them with us, or just allow us to sing over you. But you know, people want to know Jesus, and they want to know Him on their own terms. But the Bible clearly teaches that we were bought at a price, that we've been crucified with Christ, and it's no longer we who live, but Christ who lives within us. We are a new creation in Christ. We are saved by grace, through faith, a gift of God, not of ourselves. And if you are a redeemed saint here this morning, I want to encourage you to allow the Lord to be Lord of your life. May we adjust our beliefs and our framework of thinking to Scripture, because we have been redeemed.
As majestic as the mountain, as vast as the valley, deeper than the sea, higher than the sky, so is Your grace. So is Your love, glorious and free, glorious and free. As majestic as a mountain, as vast as a valley, deeper than the sea, higher than the sky, so is Your grace, so is Your love. Glorious and free, redeemed. How I love to proclaim it from the top of the hill to the rivers below. Redeemed, I will shout hallelujah for the great I am. Before the Son of Man, I stand redeemed. As majestic as a mountain, as vast as a valley, deeper than the sea, higher than the sky. So is Your grace, so is Your love, glorious and free, redeemed. How I love You. from the top of the hill to the rivers below. Redeem, I will shout hallelujah before the Son of Man. Before the great I am, I stand. Redeem, how I love to proclaim it from the top of the hill to the rivers below. Redeem, I will shout hallelujah before the great I am. Oh, before the great I am, I stand redeemed. I stand redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I stand redeemed. My life is not my own. You are the prize. I stand redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, who was and who is and is to come. I stand redeemed by the Son.
Teach us the truth of the revelation of the living God. Jesus, it's in you that we live and move and have our being. Amen.
Well, good morning. He said that it is indeed a privilege and an honor for me to be here. I'm grateful for the invitation, and I'm grateful for your presence. I wasn't too grateful for the storm this morning that woke me up, but that was okay. We made it through that, and it stopped in time for us to gather here together. And I just want you to know I've looked forward to this for quite some time. And I want to share something with you today that means a great deal to me and has meant a great deal to me for quite some time. And something that I believe is very important for us to hear and to understand. I want to share with you an admonition that someone should have given the NBA All-Stars before the most recent NBA All-Star game, and that is, please don't forget to play defense. I don't know if any of you saw the NBA All-Star game or watched whatever part of it that you could, but even within the game, it looked like the slam dunk contest was not over yet because nobody wanted to play defense. Nobody wanted to put a body between the man and the best bucket. Nobody wanted to box out for rebounds. Everybody just wanted to score and have highlights and whatever else. And it just somebody just needed to remind them not to forget to play defense. I want to remind you of that today. I want to remind you of that as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't forget to play defense. Now, that may sound odd for us to be sort of defensive, if you will. I didn't say be defensive. I said play defense. There's a difference between the two. And if you want to understand the difference between those two, open your Bibles with me to the New Testament book of 1 Peter, to 1 Peter chapter 3, beginning at verse 13. 1 Peter chapter 3, beginning at verse 13. It reads, "And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good character, or good conduct rather, in Christ, may be ashamed. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. The man just said, don't forget to play defense. To give a defense to anyone who asks you. And in case you've been wondering, people are asking more and more all the time why it is that we choose to believe what we believe. And there are several things that we see here in this text that I believe are incredibly important and pertinent for us to look at in the days in which we find ourselves. The first is this. Playing defense spiritually always occurs within the context of aggressive opposition. And look at what he says there in verse 13. Who is there who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? Some of your translations say, if you prove zealous for what is good. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed, and do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. Don't be afraid of their threats. Who is there to harm you if you prove zealous for what is good? There is aggressive opposition referred to here in this passage. And in case you are wondering, there is also aggressive opposition in the culture in which we live. I don't know how many of you saw the interview with Diane Sawyer the other day about this movie with Mel Gibson. It opens today, in case you were wondering. Today's the day that it opens. I know you probably weren't aware of that. I don't know if you saw that. What you saw was the definition of hostility against people of faith. What you saw was not just an undercurrent or a stirring. What you saw was bold-faced, all-out, aggressive, not just innuendo, but aggressive attacks. When someone who claims to be an objective journalist looks at a man who made a movie about the gospel and did so by taking the book and saying in a film what the book said in the book, looks at him and says, yes, but historians don't believe that this is really, really true. That's outright aggression. You see, you may not have caught it, but here's what that reads in TV land. In case you need someone to interpret TV land for you. What it reads is, you know, people who are intelligent don't believe this actually happened. That's aggressive opposition. Aggressive opposition from the outside. Don't talk to me about this smoke screen. It's anti-Semitic. It's going to make people hate the Jews. Irony of ironies. When Schindler's List came out, we didn't have interviews saying, well, wait a minute, don't you think this might make people hate Germans? When Roots came out, nobody was saying, wait a minute, we can't let this out. People might start hating white folks. The only question was, is it accurate? Is it accurate? But that's not the question here. By the way, notice that the film is not being attacked. The man is being attacked. Open, outright, aggressive opposition. Not only do we face opposition in our culture on issues like this, but there is a general opposition because of a philosophical mindset that exists. This mindset of religious relativism, that all religions are basically the same, and that anyone who believes that their religion is right and someone else's is wrong, doesn't have a place at the table of discussing ideas. Why? Because the other idea that goes along with religious relativism is the idea of tolerance.
Now, when I say tolerance, mind you, I'm not talking about the kind of tolerance that led Voltaire to say, I may disagree with what you say, but I will defend to the death your right to say it. No, I mean the new definition of tolerance that has caused one public school administrator to say, it is the mission of the public school not to tolerate intolerance. You may be wondering, like I, what do you call the act of not tolerating intolerance? Could it be intolerance? I want you to understand something. The answer to that question is no. Those of us who follow the Lord Jesus Christ make up one of the only groups in our society today against whom it is acceptable to be intolerant. I want you to know that. We are living and operating in an atmosphere of open, aggressive opposition. Neutrality is not an option here. And us playing defense is necessary because of this open aggression. You see it there in that first verse, but look at this. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. Verse 15, but here's what we do instead. Don't be scared. Instead, sanctify the Lord God in your heart. Stop right there. This act of playing defense, this act of defending what we believe and why we believe it is an act of submitting to the lordship of our God. It is an act of obedience to God. Enough already for this idea that apologetics or defending the faith is for people who have certain kinds of degrees from certain kinds of institutions. If you believe that, look at what Jude argues. Jude argues, if you look at the first couple of verses there, he's talking to the beloved, to those who are kept, those who are the called. It is the responsibility of every believer to be able to defend, to give an answer for what you believe and why you believe it, not for a select few, not for people with certain kinds of education in certain kinds of areas. It is an act of submitting to God's lordship to be ready to defend what you believe. All of us, whether you're 16 or 60 in this room today, all of us, it is an act of obedience to God to be able to give an answer to anyone who asks you. And now, because this movie is out, people are not just going to be asking questions of theologians. They're going to want to know, where do you stand? What kind of answer do you need to give? I'm glad you asked. Look at the next part of this passage. And always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you. A defense, a reasoned response. The Greek word used here is the word from which we get our word apologetics. Give a reasoned response. In case you were wondering, that's what I've always been taught is not a reasoned response. In case you were wondering, that's what my denomination believes is not a reasoned response. In case you were wondering, the world in which we live will chew you up and spit you out if that is your answer. Those of you who are about to get ready to go off to college, there are college professors waiting for you. They are drooling at the mouth right now at the prospect of a student coming into a classroom one day and being baited with some question related to faith and having that student say what they believe and then come back and ask them why they believe it and have them say, well, that's just the way I was raised. You won't see it, but there are ticks going off in the philosophy professor's mind when he hears that, and he's frothing at the mouth. You may, if you look real close, you can see the beginning of it, because he waits for this moment to be able to pounce, because that's not good enough. Borrowed faith is insufficient for playing defense on the scale that we're talking about here. What do you believe, and why do you choose to believe it? There is a time when borrowed faith is all we have. And for a while, that's okay. But there comes a time when you've got to decide for yourself. If you haven't decided for yourself, you cannot give a reasoned response for what you believe and for why. And you'll be backed into corners and bullied all of your spiritual life. All you will ever be able to do is pick up the phone and try to find someone who can tell you what you believe. Or watch a television or listen to the radio and wait for somebody to instruct you as to what you ought to say about specific issues. Folks, this movie is opening today. You better know what you believe about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You better know what you believe about his death, his burial, his resurrection. You better know what you believe about it. There's another aspect here. Look at what he says. With meekness and fear. Meekness or gentleness. By the way, there's a difference between meekness and weakness. He's not calling here for us to be weak. Meekness is power under control. Meekness is me playing football in the backyard with my 11-year-old son. I could crush him, but I choose not to. I came to faith late in life. I never heard the gospel until my freshman year in college. My mother, I was raised in the projects in South Central Los Angeles by a teenage mother, single parent, who did the best that she could with what she had. My mother was a practicing Buddhist. I didn't grow up going to church. I didn't grow up with the Bible. I didn't grow up with any of that. And so it wasn't until my freshman year in college when a guy named Steve Morgan came into a sweaty, nasty locker room and tried to share with me. And he started with this presentation that he had been taught, you know. And he starts with this presentation and realizes very early on that I don't have enough foundational information to go with his presentation, you know. He starts with the whole, you know, God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And I'm going, God? And he's saying, well, you know, the God of the Bible. And I'm saying, Bible. He's going, well, you know, can you just agree with me so I can go to the next point here? He backed up. He closed his Bible and he looked at me and he said, this is the Bible. And every day we spent at least an hour together for the next 3 weeks. And he walked me through the most important search of my entire life. Friday, November 13th, 1987, I realized I didn't have any more questions for Steve. He was coming back to the locker room to meet me that day, and I didn't have any more questions for him. I had researched everything that I could research. I wanted to know, why is the Bible distinct from other so-called holy books? I wanted to know. I mean, how do we know that the resurrection occurred? I mean, I wanted to know this. Is this just a blind leap? I'm not going to take just some blind leap. And I wanted to know these things, so I investigated these things. All of a sudden, I got no more questions. Not only do I not have any more questions, but something on the inside of me is messing me all the way up. And so I'm just, you know, I'm there, and I got it. I understand it. He's late. So I lay down on the floor there in that same locker room. He's late. I don't know what to do. So I said, God, that thing you did for Steve that he's been telling me you want to do for me, now's good. I was radically saved that day. And I love talking to people about my newfound faith. Because of the way that I came to my newfound faith, I had an incredible foundation as to what I believed and why. I was discipled by two teammates of mine at Rice University there in Houston, Texas. I'm in my apartment one day, and two guys come to my apartment and want to talk to me. And they have a Bible. But they're saying things that don't make a whole lot of sense. And I'm just uncomfortable. Well, I just made mental notes of the things that they said, went back to these two guys who were discipling me, and I said, listen, two guys came to my house, and you know I'll talk to anybody about the Word. I can't get enough of the Word. But something was wrong. They said, well, you know, tell us a little bit about it. And I told them a little bit about it. And they said, oh, those were Jehovah's Witnesses. And I said, what is that? I mean, are they us or not? I mean, whose team are they on, you know? Well, researcher Boyd goes off again. For the next week, I learned everything I could about those guys and could not wait for them to visit me again. They came back, and it was a Holy Ghost bloodbath. I just let them have it. Up one side, down the other. Just How dare you come to my house with this stuff? They try to tell me something. I said, man, you got to come better than that. Because I read, so, I mean, I just let them have it all the way from their founder down to the present day. And I would say stuff and they would be stumped and I'd say, you need to call Brooklyn? So that's what they got to call when they get stumped, you know. They got so mad and they left. I went back to the locker room the next day and I told these two guys, Brent and Nathan and Max Moss, who were discipling me. They had bought me my first Bible, taught me how to read it, taught me how to pray, taught me. I told them, I said, man, you should have been there. It was awesome. So they came to the house. They thought I was an easy mark because the last time I just told them what happened, told them about how the guys went away. Brent kind of looked at me and said, and what's going to happen now? I felt about that big. I had won the argument and lost the person. Because I did it without meekness and without reverence. I was wrong. My attitude wasn't right. Playing defense from this biblical perspective is not about hurting people emotionally. It's not about injuring people spiritually. It is not about me being puffed up and sticking my chest out because I won in an intellectual wrestling match. It's about honestly and earnestly answering people's questions when they want to know why I believe what I believe. There's a way we play defense in this family. Amen? And there's a right way and there's a wrong way to do it. Here's why. Look at the last part of this. Having a good conscience that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. Let them say anything they want about my argument, but give them absolutely nothing to say about my attitude. Can I just tell you, that was just more than a little bit hard for me. I suffer from two diseases. One is tell the truthitis, and the other one is lack of tactitis. And when they both flare up at the same time, it can be ugly. I have to remind myself that I don't just represent me. I represent something beyond me, something larger than me, something more important than just me. And so my attitude is as important as my information in this process. I don't know who you are, but you represent the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords when you are giving an answer for the hope that lies within you. I'll never forget, as a boy, I had something similar to this happen to me. I went to Coliseum Street Elementary School there in L.A. and rooted for the Trojans. And so, you know, there in Coliseum Street Elementary School, I came home one day and I had a note, and I used to come home with notes, you know, not all the time, but a lot of times. And by the way, that's why I learned how to read, because I'd bring these notes home and I didn't know what the note said, and I'd give it to my mama and she'd just be all over me like something all over something. And that just, you know, and I learned how to read so I could figure out the note. And so then they started sealing the note so I couldn't get into it. And so anyway, I bring this note home and I hand this note to my mother and I say, Ma, I don't know what's in this one, but I promise you I didn't do it. Because I've been thinking back and from the last time I caught a beat down, I haven't done anything wrong. I promise you. And so she looks in this note and she says, you're going to be bust. I said, bust? I was that bad? She said, no, Coliseum Street is an all-black elementary school. First time it had ever dawned on me. And I just thought for a minute and I said, yeah, it is. They're going to bus you to Pacific Palisades Elementary School. That just sounds like a place where there's not a lot of brothers. You know, I mean, I just... And so several of us had to get on the bus early in the morning and go to Pacific Palisades Elementary School. But the night before, a bunch of these mothers gathered some of us together. We didn't really understand what was going on. It wasn't like a scheduled meeting, but they just started talking to us. I want you to know something. I cannot remember one boy that I played with in the projects where I live who had a father living in his home. Not one. Matter of fact, I remember a couple of boys who visited with us for a while, whose father lived with them. After they played football with us in the field, we went over their house, and nobody said why, but I believe we went to see what it looked like to have a man in the house. So we're gathered together with all these mothers, and they start telling us stories. They start telling us about guys like Benjamin O. Davis, Jr. and Sr., the first black brigadier generals in the Army and Air Force, respectively. They start telling us about guys like D. Hart Hubbard, Wilma Rudolph. They start telling us these stories about Nat Turner. They're telling us all these stories. And we didn't understand why they were telling us these stories. And then they just dropped the bomb. They said, you're going to a place where a lot of people have never seen a black person before. And like it or not, you're going to represent all of us. I put two and two together. Like, man, so you're saying now I just got to be good, right? I got in trouble all the time at Coliseum Street Elementary School. Never had problems at Pacific Palisades. Because as a nappy-headed little black boy from the projects, I got on the bus every day reminded of a simple fact. I represent more than myself. Was that fair? Probably not. But it was real. And as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, you represent something more than yourself. Don't you ever, ever, ever forget that. You stand on the shoulders of giants. Do not bring disgrace to them. And there's the final piece here, and we're done. It is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. It's better if it's the will of God to suffer for doing good rather than for doing evil. You know what the bottom line is there? He starts off by saying, who can harm you? Who can harm you if you prove zealous for doing what is good? And he finishes by saying, it's better if it's the will of God that you suffer for doing good rather than for doing evil. Bottom line, no one can touch you unless God says so. And if God allows them to touch you, he will do it for his own purposes and for his own glory and for his own namesake. So if no one can touch me unless it's part of God's purpose, what do I have to be afraid of? Answer, absolutely nothing. What can you do to me? Nothing unless my Father says so. And if my Father allows you to do it to me, whatever it is for his glory and for his honor and for his namesake. So while you do whatever you do, I will live with my head held high and represent the King of Kings and Lord of Lords so that after your injustice is through, God's name will not be sullied or dragged through the mud. And all the while, I will give you an answer for the hope that lies within me, regardless of the cost. Because greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. And unless the one who is greater says so, you can't touch this.
Stand to your feet, please. Would you take just a moment to take advantage of being in the presence of the Lord? Byron asked us a few minutes ago to draw a circle around ourselves and try to block out everything. We've been reminded that it's not our privilege to do that on a long-term basis. Our lives are connected together. We are community. We represent that community. But the decision to do that begins on an individual basis. Would you renew your commitment right now as I do mine? To play defense, to play it with integrity, to play it with the Spirit of Christ. Would you renew your commitment this morning not to live your life on a borrowed faith, Father, your children worship you this morning and the commitments of our hearts right now. You've spoken clearly to us, pointedly. You've challenged us and you've stretched us. Lord, we're reminded again this morning that the defense of the faith doesn't come by osmosis. It doesn't ooze into us. But we're responsible for being diligent students of your word to know how we might give a defense for the hope that dwells within us. God, we need your help even for that. So we pray for grace right now. Grace to not be passive, but to be aggressive and active in our pursuit of our convictions. And God, we would pray, whether it's prompted by this movie that comes out today or by the saltiness of our lives on a day-by-day basis, God, we pray that you would bring on the questions. God, you would bring on the prejudice that might come against us for our faith. We pray that you might bring on, Lord, any persecution that you and your sovereignty would allow, if it would give us occasion to speak for you and to bring glory and honor to your name. For it's in that most holy name that we pray. Amen. God bless you. I forgot.